Now we are going to move further into some realistic applications. We are going to introduce dependence between constraints and variables. Now, as we have said earlier, in all previous applications that we have so far, we have seen so far in this class, we have seen that the feasible solution space of the mathematical programming models that we have introduced are represented as the intersection of the solution sets of the constraints. So when you give a set of constraints in the mathematical model, you are basically saying that all in the optimal solution, the choice of the decision variables should satisfy all of these constraints. However, in real life, there are some situations where we are not supposed to satisfy all of the constraints, but a sufficiently large number of them, maybe. Okay? Or a determined number of them, maybe. So these kind of situations will create some relationships between the constraints. For example, you can say that we have two constraints. Either one of them should be satisfied. You can also satisfy both of them, but at least one of them should be satisfied. So in the optimum solution, you are not supposed to satisfy both of the constraints, but you need to satisfy at least one of them. We are going to see such an application in the precedence constraints, and there are some conditional constraints which can be defined in such sense. There are either or constraints, which means one and or the another of the constraints should be satisfied, but both of them cannot be satisfied at the same time, or one of them should be none of them we should satisfy at least one of them, but they cannot be satisfied at the same time. So it is a little different than the previous definition. Or we can simply say that out of n constraints, we need to satisfy exactly or at least k of. So there are different kinds of such relationships between the constraints. However, the only way that you can introduce the constraints in a mathematical model is to say that the feasible solution space is defined by the intersection of these constraints. Therefore, if we have such relationships between constraints, how are we going to introduce them in our mathematical model? Because when you give a list of constraints, that doesn't define a union relationship between them. Always intersection relationship. It does not say we are looking for a feasible space, solution space, which is defined by the union of these constraints, unfortunately. Therefore, we need to define a different type of constraints or different decision variables such that we will be able to define these kind of conditional relationships or dependence relationships between the constraints. Now, it is just going to be much better when you see these examples in practice. But let me tell you that in all of these practices, the way that we are going to introduce the constraints, such constraints with such dependence structure, will be enabled by the use of a binary variable. Okay, we are going to use a binary variable and we are going to reflect such relationships in our mathematical model as the intersection of constraints. So what we are meaning here will be understood in our first practice. Now we know the precedence constraints. Maybe we have seen such an example or practice in project planning courses, or in the operations research courses, we have learned about the mathematical modeling of critical path method or the project planning problems, and we have solved them using the critical path method. However, you can also solve such problems using the mathematical modeling approach by defining an optimization model. Now, in these problems, we have such situations such as precedence constraints. There are jobs, tasks, or activities which must be performed in a certain order or sequence. And the order of the jobs may be either prefixed or needs to be determined. Now, imagine you have a prefixed order. This may be due to a technical reason. And we are trying to define the starting and finishing times for each job. Now, for the other case, we need to determine the starting and finishing times of the tasks and also the sequence of jobs. For example, in the first type, you may say that there are two tasks, A and B, and A should be completed before B is being started. So that means A precedes B. So before finishing A, you can never start B. And we can simply say that the starting time of B is going to be greater than or equal to the ending time of A. But for the second case, we are basically saying that we have two tasks, A and B. One of them should precede the other one, but which one is going to precede, it is up to the decision maker. So if we say that first we are going to finish A, then we are going to start B, we shouldn't forget that the other way is also an option. We can start B first, then once we finish B, we can start A. So this is going to be the order of the jobs should also be determined here. But still, there is a precedence relationship, but it is much more flexible. In the first type, there is a prefixed precedence relationship because we exactly know the first task that we need to perform, which task precedes the second one. Okay, so let's just say we have two tasks, A and B, and the durations of these jobs are denoted as DA and DB. And they are exactly known, they are deterministic. Whenever you start A, it doesn't matter when you start, the duration of the first task is always going to be equal to lowercase DA. And whenever you start task B, the duration of the task is going to be DB. Now, here in this example, it is taught that task B cannot be started until task A is finished. Okay, which means task A precedes task B. There is a prefixed order of these two tasks. Before finishing A, you can never start job B. Now, how we are going to formulate such a precedence constraint is easy, and maybe you have seen about this in your earlier practices. We say that we need to define two decision variables for these two tasks. XA is going to be the starting time of task A, and XB is going to be the starting time of task B. These are the decision variables. Obviously, because we know the deterministic durations, the ending times can easily be calculated. For example, if you start task A at XA, at time XA, by adding DA to XA, you will be calculating the finishing time of task A. Similarly, by adding DB to task starting time of task B, you will be calculating the finishing time of task B. Now, according to this prefixed order of tasks, this precedence relationship, where A precedes task B, you should say that the termination time of task A, which is XA plus DA, or ending time, should be less than or equal to XB. So you can start the second task, task B, after you complete task A. Now, remember, here the decision variables are XA and XB, and the known parameter is DA. Therefore, we are taking this constant to the right-hand side, and the decision, we collect decision variables on the left-hand side to obtain a much elegant model. And we should say that either XA minus XB should be less than or equal to DA, or you can say XB minus XA is going to be greater than DA. Now, still, you can physically understand what the constraint on the right-hand side means. The difference between the starting time of B and the starting time of A should be positive, and it should also be greater than the duration of the task A, because we cannot start B, task B, before task A is complete. Now, of course, there is another case here that we should introduce these constraints. The second case, we say that there should be a precedence between these two tasks. However, there is a flexible ordering of these two tasks. So either task A should precede task B, or task B should precede task A. Okay, so it is up to the decision maker which one is going to be completed before the second one starts. So this means either you are going to satisfy the constraint as you have defined earlier, you should say that either task A precedes task B, which means the ending time of the task A should be less than or equal to the starting time of task B, or you can satisfy that the ending time of task B is going to be less than or equal to the starting time of X A. Now you see this is an either or type of constraint, which means you have to satisfy either the first constraint or the second constraint. You cannot satisfy both of them, and you should satisfy at least one of them. So this is an either or type of constraint. Either you need to satisfy the first one, or you need to satisfy the second one. Now, again, if you introduce these two constraints in your mathematical model, let's just say it is a linear programming formulation. If you introduce both of these constraints, then the mathematical model is just going to take the intersection of these two constraints in the feasible solution space. And as you can easily understand here, both constraints cannot be satisfied at the same time. So this is infeasible. Okay. And unfortunately, there may be such situations of either or constraints, except that example. So we need to think out of the bounds here, okay, out of the example. There may be two constraints, again, in the either or situation. And it may be develop a feasible solution which satisfies both of them, okay? However, because of the nature of the problem, we should say that either one of the constraints should be satisfied, not all of them. So here it is just impossible to satisfy both of them in any way. So we are just going to say either the first one or the second one will be satisfied. Okay. So how we are going to do that? How we are going to choose which constraint we are going to satisfy? Obviously, the constraint which is going to help us in obtaining a better objective value, which is going to optimize our objective value. However, again, we need to write these two constraints in a way that their intersection is going to define the feasible solution space. Now, please be focused here. I am asking you which constraint we should satisfy. Okay. Again, this is a decision, right? So which constraint you are going to satisfy is a decision. Therefore, first, you are going to decide about the constraint that you are going to satisfy. So this is also defined as a decision variable. In fact, a yes-no decision variable, right? So let's just define an auxiliary binary variable. When this binary variable takes zero value, it is going to satisfy one of the constraints and it is going to remove the other one. Whenever it takes one value, vice versa, it is going to convert one of these constraints as active and the other one as inactive. Okay. And how are we going to do that? Again, we are going to use a binary variable here, auxiliary binary variable, and also the most famous concept in mathematical modeling, the big M penalty value. Okay. This is a very, very large value in practice. Compared to the parameters of the problem, you need to take a very large value in place of big M, but in theory, it is basically a value which is our infinitely large. Okay. So let's do that. Okay. How are we going to introduce these two constraints? Now, assume that we have two tasks. We have two durations for these tasks, DA and DB. And we are indicating that either task A is going to precede B or task B is going to precede A. So whichever we choose to start first must be finished, then we can start the other one. Now how we are going to formulate this precedence constraint in the form of an either or constraint in with for these two tasks? We are going to again think about two decision variables which are basically measured in time units. These are going to be the starting time of tasks A and B respectively, and a decision, binary decision variable Y, and Y can take either one of these two values, either one or zero. Now, if Y is equal to one, then the precedence relationship will be in alphabetical order, which means A is going to precede B, which means B is going to be started once A is completed, or after A is completed, not exactly at the time that A is complete. However, if the binary decision variable Y is equal to zero, then we say that the precedence relationship will become in the reverse direction of the alphabetical order, which means B is going to precede task A, again, which means the starting time of task A must be later than the completion time of task B. Okay. So how are we going to do that? By introducing these two sets of constraints, two constraints, my friends. Okay. Now, if you are careful, these two constraints, when you do not read the part added on the right hand side related with the big M values, big M coefficients, if you just focus on the left part, you are just going to see the two constraints that we have written earlier. Okay. So either xA plus dA is going to be less than or equal to xB, or xB plus dB is going to be less than or equal to xA. So you are exactly seeing the same two inequalities here, but this time on the right-hand side, we are adding decision variables to the above constraint. We are writing 1 minus y as big M multiplied with big M, and to the second constraint, to the right-hand side, we are adding M times y, okay? Now you see, y is going to take either one value or zero value, okay? Because y is a binary decision variable. And when y is equal to one, my friends, when y is equal to one, the first constraint, in the first constraint on the right-hand side, one minus one is going to be equal to zero. And when you multiply the big M value with zero, no matter how big the big M is, it doesn't matter. The effect of big M will be removed, and this constraint will become in the form of the original constraint. Okay. Now, when y is equal to one, again, the second constraint's right hand side will become very large, my friends, because when y is equal to one and multiplied with M, xA plus M is just going to be infinitely large. And when the right-hand side is infinitely large, the left-hand side will automatically will become less than or equal to zero. So you see, when you choose y as equal to one, the first constraint will be introduced in our model. The first constraint here will be introduced in our model, but the second constraint will be meaningless, because it will be automatically satisfied. Okay. Now, when you take y as equal to zero, in that case, the second constraint here, the contribution of the big M will be removed, and the second constraint will be active, just like in this form. However, when you take y as equal to zero here in the above constraint, m times one will be m, big M, and when you add the big M on the right hand side, obviously the above constraint will automatically be satisfied. Okay, so which means it should not be considered at all when you are trying to identify an optimal solution. So depending on your choice of y, either one of these constraints is going to be satisfied. Now when you choose y equal to one, then the second constraint will be removed and the first constraint will be active. Okay, which means xa plus dA must be less than or equal to xb, which means A is going to precede task B. Okay, and the second constraint will automatically be satisfied and the problem, the solver, will not consider the second constraint at all. However, when y is going to be equal to zero, in that case, the first constraint will be automatically satisfied due to the existence of the big M value on the right-hand side. And in the second, the big M will be removed and the second constraint will be active, which is going to force the task B to precede task A. Okay. So because y is a binary variable, either taking one or zero value, only one of these constraints will be active. Now on the right hand side, what you are seeing is basically we are taking all decision variables of the problem and obviously the big M values as well on the left hand side of the inequalities and the known parameters of the problem, which are the durations of the activities, are taken on the right hand side. Okay, so in that form, after some algebra, you will realize that either you say xb minus xa plus m 1 minus y is going to be greater than dA, or xa minus xb plus my is going to be greater than or equal to dB. Now please check again. If y is equal to 1, then the above big M will vanish and we are going to see the big M value in the second constraint, which means the second constraint will automatically be satisfied independent of the xA and xB values that you have assigned. However, the first constraint will be active, which indicates that the difference between the starting time of xB and xA should be at least equal to the duration of task A. However, if y takes the value of zero, then the m value in the above constraint will be existing and the constraint will automatically be satisfied again, no matter how which values that you assign to xb and xa. And in the second part, you are going to see no big M's anymore. And xA minus xB will be forced to be greater than or equal to dB, which means the difference between the starting time of A and starting time of B should be at least equal to dB, which is going to force task B to precede task A. So this is how we can introduce an either or type of constraint as the intersection of two constraints. What we need as an ingredient, as a binary decision variable, because we are basically trying to decide which of these two constraints in the either or relationship will be satisfied.